Hello, hello, hello. Welcome everyone to this new video, a complete overview of the Karokan defense. And what a brilliant guest we have today to teach you this opening, none other than Grandmaster Swapnil Dhopade. So Swapnil is going to be with us here and he's going to teach us this opening, which he's dedicated a huge part of his chess career. In fact, I think he became a GM playing this opening. He, after becoming a GM, he kept using this opening. So personally for me, he's one of the best Karokan players in the world, and also at least in India for sure. And I have learned a lot from him. In fact, it's one of my favorite openings. So I'm also very excited to learn from him. I was going through some of the chats before this began, and a lot of people had very interesting opinions about the Karokan, which I'm going to discuss with Swapnil. Some of you said that Karokan is dull, some said it's boring, some said it's drawish, some said advanced variation is 1-0, white always wins. So there were a lot of things. By the way, this is our thumbnail for today. The Karokan opening begins with e4, c6, d4, d5. With some variations here and there, so I guess all the people are joining in, and while that happens, let me invite Swapnil over here so that we can begin. Hello Swapnil.
Hi Sagar, thank you so much for inviting me on the stream again. It's always nice to be on ChessBase India's stream.
Swapnil, learning Karokan from you has always been my dream. When we used to play chess, you never had the time to teach me Karokan. So, so finally, I'm sure that we'll be able to, learn something here.
I think when you used to play Karokan regularly, I think you used to score quite well, right?
Yeah. I think Karokan is one of my favorite systems. And you remember, there was once a team in Maharashtra Chess League where it was you, me, Lalit Babu and Tej Kumar. All of us in one team. And I would say these are the four, leaving Vidit aside, who's now started playing Karokan a lot. But at that point, these were the players who used to play Karokan all the time. So tell us about your relationship with this opening. Was it when did it begin? Was it like love at first sight? You played one game and you felt like this is my opening.
Yeah, basically when I just started learning openings, in those days, even today, I think the focus is more on middle game and end game when you just start out playing chess. But when I first started learning some opening against e4, it was the Karokan defense, and I remember very clearly it was I.M. Shekhar Sahu who taught me the Karokan defense. And basically, I was more of a positional player right from the start. So somehow that opening really suited my style. And when I used to play in the games, I used to feel really comfortable because being a positional player, I always used to enjoy end games, right? So in most of the variations in the Karokan, you get some really interesting end games, rook end games and other end games where even though it looks quite drawish, but you can still press on. And, playing Karokan, I also improved my endgame a lot. So I also learned a lot about rook endgames and other endgames. Yeah. And I think that really helped me a lot. So I always feel that when you select opening, try to match it to your own style. But sometimes you can also select opening if you want to learn positional chess, or if you want to learn more about end games, if you want to play more end games in your games, then you can also choose an opening like Karokan, which teaches you a lot about positional chess, about end games in general. So basically it started. I think I remember my first very important victory in Karokan was in 2006 against my coach, I.M. Anup Deshmukh.
Anup Deshmukh is a very aggressive player, so to play Karokan with him is a good idea.
Right, because he always sacrifices something and then he meets your king. So it's better to be as solid as possible against him. And Karokan was a good choice. And so that was my first main victory, I think, back in 2006. And you know, when you win against such strong players early on in your career in a particular opening, that opening always kind of sticks with you forever. So Karokan, yeah, basically I scored really well in my early days, and that kind of built a relation with the Karokan defense. And yeah, it's still going on.
It's still going on. Although Swapnil is now married, the relationship still goes on with Karokan. but I think this is very true. Once you get an opening with which you start getting good results, it's very difficult to let it go. And I think it suits Swapnil's style very well. Also, he likes the games of Anatoly Karpov. His playing style is similar. We have seen in the last video, the ice and fire. Fire and ice, where fire was Shyam Sundar and Swapnil was the ice. So he likes to play positional chess, and Karokan is definitely one of these systems. So if you are playing against an attacking player, the Karokan can be a very, very potent weapon. So Swapnil, how about going to the chess board, giving an overview of this opening, and then seeing some of your best games?
Yeah, that's a good idea. So, and I also wanted to mention this thing that, you know, Karpov had always been my favorite chess player. So he used to play Karokan a lot in top level chess, and I studied a lot of his games. I studied a lot of Karokan games. So I was quite impressed by the way he used to slowly win positions, dead equal positions. So I was quite impressed by that, and that motivated me to study Karokan quite seriously.
Right, right. And Swapnil, what do you have to say about all the people here who are saying advanced variation is winning for white and exchange variation is boring?
To be really honest, advanced variation is a big headache. So any Karokan player who, you know, who really want to study Karokan, want to play Karokan on a regular basis, first he should really take care of the advanced variation, because nowadays there are a lot of ideas, especially since engines are getting stronger and stronger. There are a lot of ideas in the advanced variation which are causing headache for black players. And black players are trying different stuffs, different variations. But, you know, white is always coming up with some sort of ideas everywhere. So, yeah, I believe tackling advanced variation is one of the main things that you need to do when you study Karokan defense. And exchange variation is not at all boring, I think. There are a lot of lines in exchange variation as well, where you can just keep playing for win. Of course, you don't really get as dynamic positions as you get in the Sicilian defense. But Karokan has its own style of play. And for some people, it might seem boring, but I always enjoyed those cool and calm positions where, first of all, you equalize from the black pieces, and then you slowly gain some slight initiative, keep pressing. And just imagine a situation where your opponent is playing with the white pieces and he did not get any advantage out of the opening. And slowly you turn a table, slowly the tide is coming your way. And you gain some slight initiative, and basically you manage to win the game, and you turn up the pressure with every move. You manage to win the game slowly, and the opponent might feel after the game that he simply did not get any chance, right? So this is what happened in many of my own games.
Okay, we are going to see some of those games, but before that, Swapnil, the first move for white is e4. We begin with c6. And right. And how does it go? Is d4 the main move, right? So there are some variations without d4, but we'll come to it. This
right.
is the main.
So d4, d5, right?
Position.
But okay, nowadays I think knight c3 and knight f3 has also become one of the main weapons.
Really? Okay. So knight f3, d5, and knight c3. This is the.
Yeah, this has been played quite recently in a lot of top level games. And this is something that black needs to take seriously while preparing the Karokan. But okay, let's first go to the d4, second move d4.
Yeah.
d4, d5. And now here, white has three main options. One is to play knight c3 or knight d2 for that matter, same. Because we are going to take d into e4. So this is known as the classical variation of the Karokan.
Yeah.
And here we develop our bishop to f5. There is also one line knight d7. But bishop f5 is by far the main move here.
Yeah, knight d7, I think Karpov used to like playing this. It's maybe called the Smyslov variation. Then you put your other knight here. It's a little passive because the bishop is on c8. here.
Yeah, so I was not a big fan of this 90s version from the start, because the whole point of Karukan, which I feel if you compare it to French, is to somehow, you know, give this light square bishop a breathing space, right? Take it out of the pawn chain and then place it. So I believe bishop f5 is more in the style of Karukan.
Hmm.
So knight d7 seems a bit passive to me. So bishop f5, and now there are two options: knight c5, knight g3. Knight g3 is by far the main move here.
So,
but of course, I have this side line, knight c5. Yeah,
and there is this main move. By the way, we have Nuber Shah Sheikh in the chat, who is also a very good Karukan player.
Right.
And Nuber, thanks for joining in. In fact, there is a video of Nuber on our channel where he is given e5, c5.
I think he plays regularly c5 move.
But I think Swapnil, you are not going to recommend c5, are you?
No, I am recommending bishop 5.
That's Swapnil style. That's Mr. Ice for you. You know, he's not going to go for any pawn sacrifice or anything. Very solid. But okay, coming back, knight c3 or knight d2.
So d4, knight e4, bishop f5, knight g3.
Yeah, knight
g3. Bishop g6, of course. And now h4 is the main move. So,
oops, sorry. Bishop f5, knight g3, bishop
j6, and now h4. So this is the main move for white. White gains space on the king side immediately, and then he will decide how to exactly continue. So first he will try to exploit the exposed position of the g6 bishop, gain space on the king side, and then he can see how to develop his pieces. So h4 is the main move, and we play h6 here. And now the correct mode according to me is to play knight f3 in this position, knight d7, so preventing knight e5. And white plays h5, bishop h7, bishop d3, bishop into d3, queen into d3. So this is the standard stuff till here, and after e6. So there are two major options for white. One is to play bishop d2, and the other one is to play bishop f4. And I must say that, you know, there were a lot of games played before as well, but really a very important moment for the white players was that when Negi, Parimarjan Negi, famous grandmaster from India, he released two volumes.
Yeah.
I think he will release three volumes on how to play against, how to play with e4. So he released three volumes of the e4 reporter, and what he suggested against Karukan were followed by a lot of players in that time. So after he released those books, bishop d2 and bishop f4, both the moves become quite famous, but I think his main suggestion was bishop d2. So a lot of players followed it, and I myself faced bishop d2 in a lot of games, and at first basically I didn't know how to exactly react to it, but and I faced a lot of problems in my own games. Then I found a lot of ways to fight against his recommendations, and then of course I achieved a pretty comfortable position out of the opening.
Okay.
So bishop d2, let's say we play knight gf6. Another way for black to play is to play queen c7 and go for long castle. I think Karpo played this a lot. He used to castle long. So the point is that white is going for long castles, and by castling long ourselves with the black pieces, we avoid any sort of future attack on the king side. So from here on, the game will be more of a positional nature, but black has proved in a lot of games afterwards that even castling short, if he plays accurately, he has no problems at all.
So would you recommend here castle short or castle long? Because
So I believe castle short is quite comfortable for black, because first of all, it's trending nowadays. Most of the games, if you observe, black players are going for short castles, because you know, the analysis has improved, and black is achieving comfortable positions. So I would prefer to go for short castles. And in many cases, we can also launch a counter attack against the white king on the queen side.
Okay. And so I'm always a little scared, because you have white has pushed his pawn. You also have a weakness here, kind of a hook for white to come in. But I think black is able to generate counterplay, yes, very quickly.
Correct. And the whole strategy revolves around that black should try to, enter an endgame, because all these advances which white did on the king side, this h4, h5 stuff, it's really good for him if the game the game continues in the middle game and he gets some chances to attack on the king side. But if we enter an end game, this this advance might prove to be a weakness.
So Swapnil, what I did just now is I took away the queens, and if such
a
position comes,
that's a dream position for the black, right?
You are saying this is a dream position for black. I mean, black player has nothing to worry about here.
Nothing to worry about, and a lot to be optimistic about, right?
Okay. So guys, this is a very important thing to learn here, that without the queens, this position black can be even pressing, because this pawn suddenly starts looking a little fishy and this square might be weak. There are a lot of, when you push a pawn, there are weaknesses naturally created. Okay, coming back.
And one more thing we could have added in that position is that if the white pawn from c2 is on c4, then it is even more problematic for white.
Okay, so talking about this position, if the pawn is on c4, it's more,
and we managed to exchange queens, it is really problematic for white.
Why?
Because first of all, we can break with b5, so that allows ready-made counterplay for white, and also we can pressurize the d4 pawn, and white doesn't have the c pawn to protect it with c3.
Okay, so c4 can often be met with b5 trying to fight for the d5 square, and also c4 can be met with c5 often.
Correct.
Okay, so let's go knight f6, and I think white always long castles in such positions.
Long castles, and now bishop e7. So we prepare for short castles.
Swapnil, to tell you the truth, I know that advance is right now the biggest headache for black in the Karokan. But when I used to play Karokan, this position was really a big headache for me as well. Like, I used to always be stressed that white would prepare some kind of a new idea where g4, g5 would come in very quickly and I would get checkmated, you know. So there was a move like king b1 here, there is knight e4 here, there is queen e2 here, there is knight f1, there is sometimes rook h e. I mean, so many possibilities. How to prepare against such a line?
You are correct that if white gets in g4, then it could be really, really risky for black. Because, you know, this g4, g5, everything comes so smoothly for white on the king side. But basically, you should know the ideas very clearly in this type of positions. First of all, as far as possible, we should try to avoid playing g4. Because right now, even white will require some time to move the knight away from g3 and get in g4, right? So the position, becomes very concrete, especially if you are playing against a strong triple-layered player from the white side, because he knows his ideas. So it's very important to prepare this position concretely at the top level, especially if you are playing higher rated. So every move, for example, if white plays king b1, we should answer with our different stuff. If white plays knight e4, we are going to play something different. So on every move, our response depends on how white exactly continues in this position.
Okay,
but everything is aimed against white's advance of g4.
So this is the main thing in mind, and you are not afraid to castle. Basically, that's the point. You can castle at the right time. So what is the main variation that people should know in this position?
I think king b1, which was suggested by Nagy, is the main line. So we should go for short castle, and now knight e4.
Yeah, see, he's begun. Like, if white was given a chance, he would simply waltz down his pawn down the board. So what to do?
Correct. So I think every move matters in this position. So we cannot play some cool move like rook e8, for example, and white will just start attacking our king immediately with g4. And essentially it might just be over, because it is so difficult to defend against this attack.
I mean, when you move the knight away, there's bishop into h6, you will get checkmated within a few moves. So believe me, you need to be prepared for this. So you're just one move away from destruction. As Nuber also rightly points out in the chat, life is tough if white gets in g4.
Yeah, that's right.
So what to do?
So we have to exchange the knight first on e4 and bring in our other knight to f6. So this is a very standard reaction. Whenever white offers this exchange of knight on e4, we should take the knight and put our other knight on f6. One of the main points is that it frees our queen's route to the d5, to the central d5 square. So after queen e2, So again, white is aiming for g4, right?
Yeah.
And our main idea, our main strategic aim is to try to exchange queens as soon as possible. So we play queen d5. And now g4 would be a big mistake, because white can not a big mistake, but it is not going to give white anything, because black can just play queen e4. And if bishop e3, now we take on.
So g4. Now, if you look at this position closely, white would really love if he didn't have to exchange the queens. So basically, if queens weren't exchanged. So therefore, one of the main ideas here is bishop e3 preventing the queen exchange. But I think then you go knight g4 and you gain a knight crucial tempo to take the bishop.
So one more important thing to remember in this type of positions is that white is trying to attack, and the dark square bishop is a really important attacking piece for white. So if we manage to grab the pawn on g4 and also later on exchange the dark square bishop, most of the time black is safe. Because the dark square bishop is gone, and that 6 pawn is quite safe now. So if you manage to do that, I think black should be fine.
Okay, so basically something like rook dg1 can be met with knight e3, pawn takes, and this position is much easier to defend because he no longer has the bishop here. By the way, in the chat someone asks, what is the big deal if he goes g4 and you allow g5? For example, let's say I play a5, he goes g4. Yeah. I play a4, and now g5 takes.
Right.
I think already bishop g5.
We can also continue with h6 directly.
h6. And you see that this line is opening up. Even this rook will come in. Bishop takes. It's a very powerful attack that comes in after g4, g5.
Yeah.
So,
correct. Because I have personally faced these types of attack a lot, and I've been met it many times as well.
Really?
So, yeah. Oh. So I know how dangerous this attack can be.
Well, you become an expert only when you burn your hands, and that's what Swapnil has done in this opening. So g4 is not good, because after queen takes, he has to exchange the queen, and then after this, black is fine.
Yeah, black is fine, but practically I think black is the one who usually presses, as far as my experience goes, because first of all, you know, when you are in an attacking mode and suddenly your queens get exchanged, practically it becomes, you know, a bit difficult to continue with the same optimism, because you don't have any attack, and suddenly the game transposes to an end game. So usually black gets a moral victory when he manages to exchange queens.
Absolutely. Okay, brilliant. So can't go g4 here. So what does he do here after queen d5?
So white plays bishop e3 first, and now he wants to play g4 again next move, or at some point, let's say now he wants to play knight e5, and next move he wants to play g4.
Yeah,
so we play queen b5.
This is Swapnil line. This, guys, this, if I check in the reference database, I don't know how many games, I can't see it right now, but 1 second, Swapnil has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 games in this position. He has drawn with Gawain Jones 2668, beat Masija 2550, drawn with Abhimanyu Puranik, beaten Shyam Nikhil, beaten Himal Gusain, and beaten Sankalp Gupta. Oh my god. So you can even write a full kind of a chapter on this position.
Yeah, basically I've achieved very good success in this line, but only after losing in this line from the black side.
Yeah, but you never lost with queen b5, right?
No, before that, like white played king b1, and I was completely unaware of what is going on, and I got into a bad position immediately, though I managed to draw that game later on. But it was a learning experience for me, and then I decided that I need to do something about this opening, because a lot of white players were following Nagy's book, and it was becoming kind of a headache, you know.
Okay, so now again, the point is, if he takes the queen cb, you are okay with this position?
No, I'm the happiest person in the world.
You are the happiest person in the world. Why? Can you explain?
Because as I said earlier, exchanging queens is a dream position for black. And first of all, black knight's knight gets a very safe square on d5, a very stable square. He cannot be removed with c4 moves or something like that. And also, we can create a lot of counterplay on the queen side by playing rook c8, b4, a5, a4. So it is black who is going to play in this position.
sorry. So you start playing here and your knight is beautiful on d5. Got it. So he can't take the queen.
Right, he cannot. So he has to play c4. Queen f5 check. And now king a1. And now now we play c5. So yeah, basically again, this is, I must say, even though we are like 19 moves into the theory, this could still be called as a starting point because
guys, this is grandmaster preparation, but I completely agree with Swapnil that here you should know your theory very well, because if at the right moment white goes g4 or g5 or something like that, you can come under attack.
Right, so I think we can stop in this line because the theory goes like, right, as we discussed in one of the streams, it could be like 30 to 35 minutes deep.
But you get a feel, like I think the viewers get a feel of what this line, classical line, is all about. The ideas here, you have to basically firstly take on e4 if he develops his knight to d2 or c3, both are possible. You, it doesn't matter for you, it's the same. Knight d2, takes, and now you go bishop f5. Now knight c5 is one move, but knight g3 is the main possibility, and then bishop g6, h4, h6. You play your knight to d7, stopping e5, knight coming here, and then you exchange the bishops, e6, bishop d2, you put your knight on f6, develop, and here castle. And I think one of the main moves is knight e4. You exchange the knights basically here. Takes knight f6 and put your queen on d5 with queen e4. And remember, guys, remember the Swapnil variation. Swapnil, can I give this your name?
That would be too much, I think. Yeah, but okay, I played a lot of games. But
did anyone play before you? Queen b5.
Yeah, I think I told you before as well that one game between Dipsen Gupta
In Hindi, Chess Base India Hindi, you had mentioned. By the way, guys, there was this Nikhilesh's, he had done this marathon of 6 hours of streaming on International Chess Day where Swapnil explains this line in some more depth. So you can check it out there. Okay, so Swapnil, classical variation, we get an idea. Let's move to the advanced variation.
We can move to the exchange variation first and then tackle the advanced variation.
Okay, exchange. So I find this personally not boring, because contrary to the French defense, where you get a symmetrical structure. You see, white has 3 pawns here, black has 3 pawns, white has 4 pawns, black has 4 pawns. It's a symmetrical structure.
Right.
In Karo Kann, when the opponent takes, it's basically an asymmetrical structure.
Correct. So there are like white will try to, black can also try to play on the queen side, and white usually tries to play on the king side. But mainly, so here the main line is to play c4. Nowadays, of course, white is trying a lot of different and slow stuff. So I think one of the games which we'll be seeing against, my game against Granda Zuniga, he tried a slow line in that game. Which is of course being played a lot these days.
Which one? Slow but line C4, means?
So low line means you can play c3.
You mean this line, yeah? Bishop d3.
Yeah, c3, bishop f4, all that
knight
stuff.
C6.
Knight c6, c3.
I remember Bobby Fischer once played this to beat Petrosian with white.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. But it's not dangerous, yeah, this line?
Yeah, it's not dangerous, but of course black should know his stuff well. But in general, yeah, white just tries to play on idea and just tries to get a game out of the opening.
Okay, so we'll come to that game when we see Granda Zuniga's game.
So the main move is c4, knight f6, knight c3. And when I just started playing Karo Kann, I used to play very simply, like e6, bishop e7, short castle. And most of the time you get an isolated queen pawn position. And you know, I was real. I used to play this line a lot, and I used to be so comfortable and so confident that no one can meet me in the isolated queen pawn. And I think we used to have these debates as well, that isolated queen pawn is often, it could be quite dangerous. But playing this position from the black side and playing against the isolated queen pawn, I got a lot of confidence, and I learned a lot on how to exactly deal with isolated pain points. So if someone wants to learn these types of important structures, Karokan can be a very good choice.
Okay. So knight c3 here, how do you continue?
So we can play e6, but I would recommend knight c6 these days. So knight c6, knight f3 is one thing, and the other thing is bishop g5. Both the variations are equally important. So here we can play bishop e6, we can play knight e4, we can play e6. So a lot of variations are there, but bishop b6 would be my recommendation.
Bishop e6. Okay. I had prepared knight e4 when I was playing with black.
Okay.
And I felt this was interesting line, the line which went d e d5, knight e5, queen d4, and then you have to sacrifice a pawn for F6, compensation,
right?
Yeah, f6, then queen e4 was
a line. Dynamic line.
Then I think you go g6 with the idea of bishop f5, bg7, quick castling. So I like that, but Swapnil mentions here bishop e6, okay?
Right. So the point is that we support the d5 pawn, and we prepare to fianchetto our bishop with g6, bishop g7.
Okay.
So if I play knight c3, we are going to play g6.
Knight f3, yeah?
Yeah, knight f3, g6, bishop f6, ef6, c5.
I'm a little bit scared of queen b3, no? That doesn't...
Queen b3, always, I think, most of the time, it is made by knight a5, kicking the queen away.
And
check bishop d7.
Check, then you have this move, and next move, you can just pick up this pawn.
Correct, right. So queen b3 doesn't really work, even though b7 looks, it looks quite tempting to attack the b7 pawn. So usually, cd5 is also one of the moves here, but black is completely fine after bishop d5. We need to check with e7.
Knight e7.
And now,
not bishop e7?
I think bishop e7, queen b5 is, I'm not sure about it.
Okay.
Maybe bishop f3, gf3, maybe even that is possible, but I've felt that knight e7 is quite simple.
Knight e7, and you want to put your bishop on g7 and castle.
So not, coming in between our plans. And after knight d5, queen d5, queen b5 check. There is an endgame with opposite color bishop, which is completely fine for black. So this is one of the sample lines.
Equal position, and then Swapnil likes to grind his opponents in such positions.
Yeah, that's the plan.
Okay, so this is one way to tackle bishop g5.
And the other move for white is to play knight f3. When there is an endgame line which has proven itself to be very, very solid for black. So bishop g4, cd5, knight d5, queen b3. Bishop into f3. White has to take on f3, and then we play e6. So this is queen b7, knight d4, bishop b5 check. Looks very dynamic, but it has been played a lot of times. And yeah, the position reaches an endgame after knight into b5, queen c6 check. A very nice intermediate, forcing the king to go to e7.
Now it's important, because if you would have taken on b5 directly, then you can go queen d7 and black is completely fine. But giving this check means you cannot block with queen d7, because queen into a8 is hanging. So you have to play now king e7, which is uncomfortable for sure.
Right. And now queen into b5.
He takes.
And then queen d7. So yeah, basically after knight d5, queen d5, queen d5, d5, there's an endgame. But in general, black is completely fine in this endgame. So we just need to play king e6, and in some positions we also go to f5 with king f5. Mainly we just need to remember to play bishop b4, rook c8, bishop c5. All these ideas are there. We need to study this endgame a bit deeply. But in general, black is completely fine, as is proven in a lot of games.
Okay. I would just add here that I had once prepared take.
Yeah, actually, I must say that I won a lot of games with this move
take,
as well.
Take and rook b8. This was my small preparation. In fact, it's very tricky because you want to give a check with a3, and once king f6 comes, actually black starts to be better in such positions.
Yeah, correct, correct. So the, here I think the main line is to win the pawn with queen c5 check, queen a7. But even after being two pawns down on the queen side, black has some compensation.
Yeah, after bd6, I remember that here black is doing completely fine. So this is definitely one option that you can check. Okay, so this is an endgame line that you have to play. Is it forced to go into this, or you can?
We can also play g6 actually, if you want to maintain, you know, if you want to get a fighting game. But if you want a very solid option, then bishop g4 is, of course, definitely black's choice. Okay.
Right, and if you face some opponent who is going to play bishop e2 or something very passive with you, you are the happiest in the world after, say, e6 or d into c4. I mean, basically, once black gets bishop e7, castles, dc4, he's going to make your life miserable against this isolated queen pawn, especially with the bishop already developed on g4.
Right.
So that was about the exchange variation.
Correct. And now we go to the main headache for black players, that is e5 advanced variation.
Yeah, this is the biggest headache. Let's see what Swapnil has against this d4.
So basically, in my career, I've tried a lot of ways to deal with advanced, but I must say that I've experienced problems in many of them. So I usually try to keep a lot of options against the advanced variation. For example, as Nubair pointed out, he is the one who plays c5 regularly. So I have also tried c5 on occasions, and with mediocre success, I have won some games, but I have lost to strong players like Lesnica Victor. And I still believe that bishop f5 is the one that black should play.
Nubair, are you listening? Bishop f5 is what you should be playing, yeah, so according to Swapnil. By the way, Nubair says, I have defeated Gavin Jones on online tournaments titled Tuesday in the same endgame. So black can also play for a win in that endgame which you showed in the exchange variation.
Nice.
Great, Nubair. If you can put in the link of that game. He's put in the link as well. Fantastic. Okay, guys, you can check that.
Nice.
So, bishop f5. What do you do here? I think white has many ways.
So, basically, there are many ways. One of the games which we would be seeing is my game against Iliano, where he played knight d2. And suddenly, I observed that after our game, this line started to trend again. So, knight d2, basically, black is going to play e6 and c5 break, right? So, that's his main idea. So knight d2, knight b3 is aimed against black's c5 break. So, and anyways, you know, the knight usually goes to the b3 square. Only in this case, white transfers his knight immediately to the b3 square, making it difficult for black to achieve the c5 break. So knight d2, knight b3 is one of the lines. Another line for white is to play h4 instead of knight d2. So the point is to play g4 next move and start playing against the bishop on f5. And also one of the ideas is, of course, to gain space on the king side. We play h5 here. There are other lines as well, but h5 is a very standard response. And now there is a very interesting pawn sacrifice here. For example, it is bishop g5, queen b6, and bishop d3.
I know this.
This is a very dangerous one. So actually, when I saw this first, I was really surprised. Maybe white blended or something, but yeah, it's a very dangerous one.
Because if I'm not mistaken, you take queen b2 is what you want to play, right?
Yeah, expecting queen c3, but white plays e6.
Swapnil, you should have asked the viewers.
Oh, sorry.
I do this morning sessions, right? So in that one of the games I was discussing with Vaibhav, and I told him e6, and he asked me, how can such a move work? And next, I think 1 hour was, or 40 minutes were spent in trying to analyze how this move after queen a1 is actually not working, you know, like b3. Queen b3 attacks b7, sometimes you go knight f3. I mean, it's so complicated, this entire position.
Correct. Right. It's very dangerous for black.
But take my word and take Swapnil's word for it, that after e6, white is better.
Correct.
So I think Queen D4, yeah, you should take.
No, I would prefer to go for a very safe option. So after Bishop G5, Queen B6, we take on D3.
Okay, typical Swapnil, typical Swapnil. No, no risk.
And now offer the queen exchange, queen a6.
Okay.
And next move, you want to play e6 and then develop our pieces normally, like take our knight to f5, break with c5 at an appropriate moment, and black is comfortable.
All right. Although I should tell the viewers that Queen D4 may be possible. I think engines do like it. Like after Bishop F5, Queen E5, you win the bishop. So he must play.
Yeah, I've analyzed this line a bit deeply, and I think it is quite possible, but some also a bit dangerous. Yeah, we need to remember the exact
Look at your
moves.
queen. Yeah, it's on G4. It's not looking so great. So I agree.
So this is one of the lines for white. Another main line is to just play Bishop D3.
Swapnil, can you tell us why does white insert this move h4 in this position? What is wh why does he do that?
One of the reasons is that, of course, he wants to gain space on the king side, but we play h5, then he will try to exploit that weakened g5 square. But black also gets something in return, right? He gets that f5, very stable f5 square for his knight. So usually we will see in many of the games that black exchanges the light square bishop and tries to put his knight on the f5 square. So white doesn't have that g4 move with him.
Right.
So both get something back and forth, but yeah. This is one of the main ways for white to play in the advanced variation. And another move that white can try instead of h4, of course, also known as the main line, the short variation, and that is to play knight f3
Okay.
instead of
Just
h4.
I think you were talking about this line once.
This is one line, so bishop d3, queen d3. And now I have played a lot of games with e6, but I feel another interesting option is to play queen f5 check first, insert this move. And only after he plays knight d2, we play e6. So in this way, we kind of, delay the development of the c1 bishop to g5 or some other square. And if he plays bishop d2, we offers the queen exchange with queen
Typical.
a6. And next move, we would like to play e6. So in this way, we stop the knight's development to the d2 square.
Okay, very nice. So
So another option for white is to play knight f3 in this position, knight f3, e6, c4, knight e7. Again, a lot of games have been played
knight
in that.
f3 e6
Sorry, not in this one. After
after
h4, h4.
h4. So bishop f5 h4. Oops, sorry. H5.
Knight f3,
Knight
e6.
f3. Okay, e6.
c4. Yeah, this is also one of the main ways. And black can play knight e7 in this position.
I think
And
Swapnil, I
yeah, there
think
are a lot
you're
of.
mixing. Maybe it's c4 e6 knight c3,
Yeah,
right?
yeah. C yeah, yeah. C4, e6, knight c3, correct. And then white plays later on knight f3. So there are a lot of variations in this line as well.
I think this is becoming very critical, this line. Maybe there is this move knight e2 if I'm not
E2,
mistaken.
yeah, correct. Knight e2 and knight f3
I
are the
have
two
big
options.
problems with knight e2.
Oh,
I don't know but what to do
okay.
against this.
Now we can just develop with knight
Okay.
d7. I think in your days you used to play bishop g4,
Yes,
right?
I
Bishop
played
g4,
once
f3,
in
bishop f5
Varna
back.
Open against Ashwin Jayaram and I had actually taken on c4 here. Knight g3, I had played b5, which was very risky.
Oh,
But
yeah.
I think maybe what you point out could be better. Yeah, knight d7
Yeah, just
and
knight d7, knight g3, bishop g6. And bishop
bg5 is the main
g5 is
move,
one move.
and then queen
Yeah,
b6,
and
right?
now, yeah, queen b6, and then we take on, let's say, queen d2. Now we take on c4 immediately. The point is that after bishop c4, black castles long. And now black is already threatening to win the pawn on e5 with knight e5. So white has to be very, very careful in this line.
Okay, got it. So this is one of Swapnil's recommendation here. Yeah, advance is quite complex. There's also the main line. I think the absolute main line these days is
Is knight
bishop
f3
e2.
and now bishop e2. And believe me, I've tried everything. I have tried knight e7, knight c8. I have tried to bring the knight to knight e7, knight g6, knight e7, knight f5.
Putting the bishop back, yeah.
Yeah, even I think f6 here, right? If I am not wrong,
Yeah.
f6.
There was this one
I
very
have.
dubious line you played once, I think, with F6, and you
Yeah,
won,
yeah, yeah.
actually.
Yeah, I managed to win that, but I also lost after that, so it wasn't so
Also,
successful.
C5, maybe you have
But
played.
I have also played knight d7 c5 everything I've tried, but now I believe I came to the conclusion that c5 is really something that black should look forward to.
So you, according to you, c5 is the kind of easiest way to equalize in this position.
The correct way to equalize, though we need to prepare a lot. So if you are very well prepared, I believe that black can achieve very good results. It's a very solid option for black, though it's very dynamic and complicated as
Rupert
well.
Saying in the chat, Sagar Bhai, you try c5, don't go for bishop f5 complications. if you play c5, number of lines reduce considerably with with bishop f5, definitely. But Swapnil, what about bishop e3 here?
We play queen b6, hitting
on
b6.
This active line. Okay.
Yeah. And now knight c3 is the correct move. And now even it's very tempting to take on b2, but we should not. We should, because queen b2, I think maybe the viewers can guess here. What is the best move for white?
White to move.
It's not
yeah,
so easy.
Yeah, yeah, it's very tricky. I remember when I first saw, I was like, what? Mouse slip or something? So guys, wake up, wake up, wake up. White to move. And what would you play here? Not at all easy move. Oh, now I understand it better. Suyog Wag, who's in the chat, says, for all these years, I thought c5 is more complicated than bishop f5. No, Suyog. Now you know. But no, actually, it's like you choose one system against knight f3, bishop e2, and then you are all set. I think Swapnil has already mentioned you can go for this line. Everyone's saying in the chat, knight b5. I am not sure if this is the best move.
It is the most logical and tempting move, I must say. Trying to win that exchange, yeah? Knight c1, check knight a8.
Let me see if anyone finds the right move. Rook b1 is one option. Bishop c1 is suggested by someone. Knight a4 is suggested. Still, I mean, not the right move, yeah? Still, a4. Or maybe I'm mistaking something, but let's see. Okay, so knight b5, it's not the best move.
Yeah, not the best move. In fact, it's a bad move because black gains an advantage after this by playing c4.
Oh, what? You're giving up a rook?
Yeah. So now we play king d7, knight into a8. And now we play bishop into, no, first bishop into c2. Queen c1 is the only move, I guess. Yeah.
Queen c1.
And now we play bishop a3.
Oh, what a move. What a move.
So, white cannot take on b2. He simply loses the a1 rook. And our idea is quite simple. We want to play, So, if it doesn't take on b2, we just want to play knight c6, knight e7, and win that poor knight on a8.
Wow. Beautiful line.
And
who said Karo Khan was boring?
Yeah, it's filled with some really dynamic and interesting variations.
Yeah.
And also, you know, once we manage to win that knight, our queenside pawn majority is just going to roll white.
Absolutely.
So b5, b4, everything.
So he shouldn't be going knight b5.
Yeah, and people who are unaware of this line from the white side, many times they just fall into this trap of playing knight b5. And I've seen many, many games where black has just won out of the opening straight away.
Fantastic. So that's a good trap.
But a correct move for white is to play queen b1.
Yes, absolutely. Queen b1. And you are all shocked. What? The knight on c3 is hanging. What's happening? Swapnil, explain what?
What's now going? Bishop d2, attacking the queen. And next move, whatever black does, we are going to take on b7. So this is the correct way to win the a8 rook. Once the queen, you know, enters black's queen side, it is just going to crush everything.
So he can't take on c3, yeah?
So black has to play queen b4. And again, the correct move for white is to play a3, being very adamant and So forcing white to black to take again on c3, but we have to play queen a5 here.
We can't take this because then rook b1
that will lead to a very inferior endgame actually.
Right.
Because our queen side is undeveloped and knight b5, all the stuffs are coming. So we need to play queen a5. And yeah, again, there is a lot of theory after queen a5, but I believe it is white who is having the initiative.
And so this queen taking b2, this?
No, now queen c3 check is winning for black.
Because now this is hanging.
Right. So dc5 is, as far as I remember, dc5 is the main move. And it leads to very, very complicated battle. So this is, of course, one trap where if you really want to get some dynamic positions on the board, if you're willing to take risks. But my recommendation would be to play knight c6 instead of taking the b2 pawn.
Oh, you don't want to take... Ah, that's Swapnil for you. Yeah, he tells you everything, but then he tells, look, this is the drawback and now you play this. Very nice. So
white castles here. Mm-hmm. Though there is also one sideline. He can play queen knight a4 in this position. And yeah, I must mention that one of my students, Ronak Sadwani, he managed to draw with the black pieces against Sergey Karyakin in this line.
Ah, at the Isle of Man.
I love.
At right. Grand Swiss, basically.
Correct.
And this was the opening. And so, babe, did you teach him this before he played?
I taught him the Karukat, but he came up with this idea and all these variations by himself.
Mm. Guys, Karyakin affected by Swapnil Dopade's preparation. And Ronak Sadwani as well. Okay, so queen f5 check.
And if I check c3, and now we play c4, cutting the knight's road back. And next move, we are going to play b5. So I think it is castles, b5, knight c5, bishop c5, dc5.
Bishop c5, dc5.
And now we play knight e7. And b4 is the correct move for white. And now black should remember a very important move, that is queen a3.
Oh. Why?
Because if we move the queen back, white is going to crush us on the queen side with a4. So we need to stop it.
Wow, Swapnil, that is deep. But can he not go something like bishop c1, you take on c3, right?
Yeah, then we win everything. Hmm. So I think the correct move is queen c1, and then it leads to a very coolish endgame. And this is how Ronak managed to draw against
Karyakin. Yeah, something like king d7 and then to a4, he went a6, yeah, and he just...
We just need to sit tightly here.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, by the way, guys, Ronak Sadwani is Swapnil's student. He's worked with him quite a lot. And also some very well-known players. In fact, when I visited his site today, chesspatshala.in, I saw testimonials by Humpy and Harika, because Swapnil was the coach of the women's team at the Olympiad. He was working with them and they have mentioned about him. So it's such an honor to be analyzing openings with him.
So the correct move here for white is to go for castle and queen b2.
Now
and again, we can try it. We can ask the viewers to find, but I think it's going to be really difficult again for white to find the best move for white here.
Okay, it's not queen b1 anymore, yeah?
Of course not.
Why? Of course not. I mean, I see queen b1. If you take on c3, queen into b7 is still looking not bad.
Now I'm going to take on b1. And I'm ready to go for long castle as well if required.
Oh, okay. So now queen b1 is not so effective, guys. Yes. So what would you play here as white? tough. Okay, let me think, Swapnil. It's a queen move, Swapnil. Am I right?
Yeah.
Yes, I know it. I have seen, maybe, isn't this the game? Fabiano Caruana versus MVL from Sinkfield Cup 2014. Where
Yeah. I think there are a lot of top level games in this line.
Guys, knight b5 is not the way to play here, because if you go knight b5, I think same thing would happen. Yeah, c4, knight c7, king d7, knight a8, bishop c2. Would that be the refutation?
King d8 is the correct move actually. And then we play bishop c2 and next move bishop a3.
Okay.
No. After c4, knight c7, king d8.
Okay.
Yeah, the only point is that we don't want rook b1 and rook b7 to come with a check.
Oh man, this is too deep. But now he has queen d2.
You know, we are going to force him to come to c1, yeah, bishop b4.
Anyway, come here, guys. Come here. I will play this and you am okay with a draw.
No, we are not okay with a draw. We are playing for a win.
Really?
Yeah.
How?
As far as I remember, I think c3 is also something which we need to watch out for.
Achha.
You don't really want to go to e1, right? Because that will be too much for you.
I mean, I'm rook up, so I was thinking I can do anything, but...
Yeah, but I think the knight on a8 is going to, you know, die at some point. Knight e7, king d7, all this stuff. So can we tell the correct?
Yes. I think Shubham Sahasrabuddhe Dakshan Chess have guessed the right move, and the move that was Queen E1 in this position. Is that right?
Correct. Yes. So in the previous version it was Queen B1. In this version it is Queen E1. So we need to remember this exact moves. Mm. Yeah, and black plays c into d4, and after that there's again a lot of theory, a lot of complications, and yeah, one needs to know it pretty thoroughly so that they can play this line successfully.
Yeah, okay, so need to know your theory here. We are going to ask Swapnil how to know all this theory later, but for now, okay, these are the main moves. What else?
I think one more very dry line if white wants to avoid theory is to play c3, c5 c3.
No, I'm very happy with this. It's like playing the French defense, but instead of bishop on c8 you have it on f5.
Yeah, right, but I think if you know, analyze this line deeply and concretely, it is still not so
really easy.
Black needs to know a lot of things.
Okay.
Because I can just show you a sample variation here. For example, if black plays knight c6, white goes for short castle. And now one of the main thing is that we need to develop our g8 knight to e7.
Yeah.
But d into c5 is coming. So we need to take on. So if we take on d4 here, so c into d4, white takes knight into d4. Now if we take knight into d4, c into d4.
So basically you can't take this pawn because after knight f5, it just ruins the structure.
Yeah, and also our king is still in the center and we don't really have time to, you know, take it to safety.
So take.
And now black would be very happy. He's getting his knight to c6. But the problem is that white start attacking on the king side with g4. Or I think first knight c3, knight c6, and now g4.
Okay.
Bishop g6, f4. And suddenly it becomes really tough for black to defend on the king side.
Yeah.
And as far as I remember, there are moves like f5, ef6, gf6, f5, and it becomes really complicated. We should remember that our king is still in the center, so it could be very risky for us if we just slip for a moment.
Yeah. I was thinking, Swapnil, if here, instead of trying all this stuff, can we not play knight h6? Because usually in such positions, I'm not afraid of him taking my knight and doubling my pawns, because this is a key bishop that he gave up.
Right. So it is also one of the possible lines, I must say. We can also play first bishop g6, then try to play knight f6.
Exactly.
A lot of possibilities are there. But we can also just play cd4, knight d4, and knight e7. So that would be my recommendation.
cd4, knight d4, knight e7.
And yeah, black gets a comfortable game. But again, we need to know some variations, some important variations.
By the way, before moving on from the advanced variation and to some people have mentioned that Shiro variation is very dangerous with knight c3, right?
Right. So e6, g4, bishop g6, knight g2. So what basically white wants to do is that he wants to play h4, but he doesn't want to allow black to play h6. So first he would like to place his knight on the f4 square, keeping an eye on the g6 bishop, so that later on he can play h4.
Wow.
And here there is an interesting variation for black. Black can play knight e7, knight f4, now c5, h4.
Okay.
Now we play c into d4.
Mm-hmm.
Knight
d5. If h5, then
h5 we just
maybe take this, yeah?
Yeah, take on C2 or take on C3, I think shouldn't be so bad as well. Yeah, this is comfortable.
Yeah, this should be
So
fine.
white needs to play knight b5 here.
Knight b5.
Also is threatening knight d6 check, which is very dangerous.
Yeah, looks scary. So knight d6 coming in, h5 coming in, trapping this bishop.
So we play knight c6, knight ec6.
No fear.
No fear. And now white plays h5.
Can we ask the viewers to think what to do?
Not now exactly. So after bishop e4, f3, then we can ask.
Okay. So white to move, black to move, f3 has come here. What do you play? So thinking now, bishop has no square to go. Oh no, what shall we do? Knight b5, queen a5, there's just bd2 because the knight on b5 is defended, so it doesn't work. How do we continue here? It's very complicated. Maybe a6 is one possibility. Queen a5 check is what everyone wants to do. But guys, queen a5, bishop d2, I don't know. What's on your mind? What? Bishop e7? I don't think that's a move. Bishop f3, queen f3, knight e5. Does that make sense? d3 is one more option. Bishop b4 check. Bishop c2. Too many options. What do you do, Swapnil?
Well, I must say people in the chat are really creative. A lot of interesting ideas.
But no
up.
One gave the right answer, yeah?
Yeah, I think you are quite close when you suggested a6. That is the correct
answer. A6, okay.
And the main line goes knight d6, bishop
d6. Oh, what about take here?
Not knight d4, because we can just take on d4 and f3 pawn falls.
F3 is hanging, yeah.
So we, white needs to play knight d6.
So knight d6, bishop d6.
No, after f3.
Sorry. f3, a6, and now knight d6.
Right, bishop d6, ad6. And still the bishop on e4 is trapped. So black needs to find another beautiful move here.
You see, Caro Kann, often when white is very ambitious, you are on the edge, you know. But if you kind of circumnavigate these complications, you end up with a better position many of the times. So that's the thing. High risk, high gains. Okay, I'm very tempted to play e5, but let's see, guys. What do you suggest now? Black to play. Can you play e5, maybe e5, knight g2 maybe is the move, but then this is what a free coaching session with Swapnil looks like. Yeah, he makes your life miserable. He's making you calculate. How do I? G5 is another move I was thinking, but knight g2 is always the issue that I find. E5, everyone says, but guys, e5, knight g2, do you have any plans after that? Or just knight b4 is one suggestion, but knight b4 just fe, I guess. Queen d6, but queen d6 fe. Queen g5 is one suggestion. Castles. Suyog Wag says castles. I can't believe castle to be working here. What is it, Swapnil?
It is g5.
G5, yeah, does it work? I was thinking, what about knight G2?
I think knight h3 is slightly better. You also attack the G5 pawn at the same time.
Which knight H3? Okay.
Yeah. So that is comparatively better because after knight G2, the knight is not going anywhere.
Yeah.
So we just play h6. Yeah. Very cool and calm and composed.
H6.
Yeah.
No worries. Yeah.
No worries. And after Fe4, D into E4, it leads to a very complicated battle. And there is a very famous game of Vishwanathan Anand here.
Really?
And, and he managed to, I think he managed to win or draw against Topalo.
Yeah, he beat Topalo. And I think the game is, Anand versus Topalo. I don't know which year it is, but yeah, I can see it in my Mega.
Right. So that is a very good game to, you know, it's a very good reference point. But of course, you can go deep in this game and analyze a lot. But in general, I feel black is doing very, very well in this position.
Yeah, because this pawn will hang and then you will have three pawns for a piece and these two monsters.
Right. And it is also going to get support of the F pawn quite soon. So black is going to play F5 next. And you can just look at those pawns. Right? It is completely paralyzing white's pieces.
Brilliant.
So a lot of interesting lines.
Very, very, very interesting.
Far away from boring.
yeah. And you know, we are just touching the surface right now, but there are so many deep ideas to look at. So Swapnil, have we covered almost everything or no?
Yeah, there are some sidelines, but we have covered the main stuff. I can also mention one thing which I think none of the books have covered till now, because it's a very recent line, and that is knight f3 in this position.
Yeah.
And now d5 and d3. Very, very strange line, you know. Black wants to exchange queens and white is ready to do that, but in fact it is also pretty dangerous, because I've seen a lot of top guys employing this line with the white pieces. Especially I myself faced this line against Jan Nepomniachtchi in one of the Title Tuesday Blitz tournament.
Okay.
And yeah, he beat me pretty comfortably because I was not at all prepared. In fact, I was quite happy to exchange.
You took the queen?
I took the queen immediately.
But I think after something like c3, king c2, white has a very comfortable position, right?
Actually, the main point is that black, again, you know, he has a very tempting move, that is bishop g4. Hmm. White plays bishop e2. And after, again, one more logical move, knight d7. Now here comes white's main point, and that is knight fd2.
Knight fd2, okay.
And so the point is that, takes. Now, if you just imagine this position when black plays e5, he has already exchanged his bad bishop for our good bishop, right? And his knight comes very steadily into black's position. For example, he's going to play knight c4, knight d2, or bishop e3. All these stuffs are, you know, rook d1, knight d6 check. So suddenly it becomes really cramped for black in this position. So even though it starts out as a very harmless line, black needs to know a thing or two in this line as well. So this is a relatively new line, and black needs to know something about it very clearly.
Swapnil, you have a course on your website on the Karokan. Does it cover this move?
Yeah, it covers this
really
move. Yes,
wow. We are going to check out that course at the end, but that means that is the only place where you get to know what to do. Yeah,
because as I said earlier, this is a very, very new line, so it is not covered in any of the books.
If I was playing this for the first time, I would go bishop g4. Does that make sense?
It makes sense, of course. You can also play a lot of things other than, let's say, you can play e6 or knight f6. But if you want to play in a best concrete fashion, I would recommend to take on e4, take on d1. Really? And then you need to know how exactly to continue from this position.
Okay. I won't spill the beans here.
Yeah.
But I don't like it, Swapnil, to exchange this and go into this endgame. But you have found a way to equalize, yeah?
Yes, correct.
Okay, fantastic. And what about the two knights here? Is that something?
Yeah, so two knights is also very, very trending move recently from the white side. And black has a lot of moves. For example, the main standard way to face the two knights is to play bishop g4. And after h3, they take on f3. So, and queen f3. And now this is a very standard way of playing. It has been played since a long time. But Nowadays, black has come up with a lot of interesting ideas. For example, instead of bishop g4, we can also play knight f6.
Ah, this is Swapnil's, and guys, here is an amazing game played by Swapnil against Karthikeyan and Murali, right?
Yeah, and I think we have covered it, right?
We have done a video, but that was before Chessbase India began. That was sometime when you were a GM, you had just become a GM in 2015. Right. So it's on my other channel, I think Sagar Shah channel, so not on Chessbase India. I think I'll transfer it at some point. But yeah. I remember that he had played some move like knight e2, and then he had gone back. He was playing he was trying to trap this knight, basically.
Right. So yeah, the knight f6 is an interesting line, but over the years, you know, since there are a lot of games played in knight f6 as well, and it's a very dynamic line. I've analyzed some new line in this position. So after knight c3, I would now recommend to play g6.
G6, wow, this is the first time I'm seeing this.
Yeah, so the main line goes 4, bishop g7, and d4, bishop g7. And now black's idea is quite simple. He would like to play bishop g4 next, hit the knight on f3, and then try to put the pressure on the d4 pawn.
But Swapnil, so, here h3 is the main move.
Yeah, h3 is the main move, and then we take on e4, knight e4, and we play knight f6.
You like this position?
Yeah, the point here is that knight f6 is the most logical move for white, and then we take with the e pawn.
Oh, okay.
And black gets a very very easy way to develop his pieces. Even though it might seem that white has a very clear majority on the queen side, just like in the Berlin, for example, but black is also very solid. So I believe that black gets a very good play in this line.
Interesting. Actually, guys, you can also play this line if you like Swapnil's analysis. Maybe this you have covered in the course.
Yeah, I've covered everything.
So if this, then I think here they can even try this move, because then you can against the classical play this line. No.
Yeah, that could be a good transposition. But when I analyzed this, I think there was some move when white could, you know, not get into this line.
Also, I somehow feel that white has a very nagging edge here, but maybe it's like what Swapnil has analyzed here with knight f6, ef6 might be very good. Otherwise, you know, it's a slightly passive position for black. Okay.
Yeah, but I think once you know how to play these positions, you will get really confident.
Okay. I should get the course. Okay. So, I think we kind of covered everything. Swapnil, we checked a lot of lines. Shall we go to a couple of your games?
Yeah, we can see one or two games.
Nuber says, what if white plays bishop d3? Okay, Nuber is also learning here. I think Nuber is going to go back with some ideas. Knight c3, g6. d4, h3, takes, knight f6, bishop d3. Nuber, my answer would be get Swapnil's course, but okay, Swapnil may tell you what to do.
Yeah, I think we can just take on e4.
Okay.
And then we play knight d7. So I think it's a very normal position. We just need to play castle, knight f6, castle, and I think we can also think about the e5 break. So for example, castle. And we can think about the e5 break. Of course, white can play bishop f4. So I think it is knight f6, bishop, and then knight d5. I think queen b6 or a5. In general, I believe this is a playable position for black. Mm-hmm. But honestly speaking, it's a bit complicated. You need to know exactly how to do it. But when I analyzed this line long back, it is, we need to try to get in the e5 break or the c5 break comfortably. So if you know the correct way and concrete way to play in this position, like I choose decent position.
Okay. Got it. Okay. Suryan Shwarma says, if third move in this two knights variation d4 is also I think this is also a popular line these days.
D4, knight e4, knight f6,
queen e2, and then you.
I in fact managed to win against Ivan Popov in this line
with black,
but with black, but it is also a bit complicated, and it's a playable option.
And queen d5.
Yeah, queen d5 or queen f5, both the lines are pretty good.
Something this he's mentioned this. I mean, I never believed a move like queen e2 can be good, but now it's kind of trending, right?
Correct.
I think we have a video on Boris Savchenko showing one of his games to Rupali when she recorded this line in Moscow Open or some tournament there. Ah, Voronezh. So, but okay, guys. So, you can avoid all of this by playing Swapnil's suggestion with g6. But, yeah, check that out. Okay, Swapnil, this is some heavy duty analysis. My file is huge. I'm going to put it somewhere. And which game shall we
okay, that you got some really interesting board up there, but let's
no that won't be seen. Yeah, so which one?
Okay, maybe we can see my game against I don't know, all the games look not tempting to be sure, but maybe you can suggest me.
I really want to see your game with Granda Zuniga and Eliano, because these two are world-class GMs, and you played the Karokan with them and you held fort. So first, maybe Eliano.
Yeah, sure.
Okay, so white is Pavel Eliano, who had a rating of 2734 back then, guys. So everyone is saying, please PGN. Guys, my recommendation to all of you, please look at the video and make your own PGN file, okay? I worked very hard putting in all the moves. So d4, d5, Pavel Eliano was 2734, Swapnil was 2532. This was at Isle of Man 2017, and Eliano was in rocking form at that point. So makes this even more interesting, the game. e5, oh, advanced.
Yeah, Bishop. Yeah, bishop f5, knight d2, e6, knight b3. So before this game, it was like there were not many games in top level chess. But as I said earlier, after this game, you know, it became trending once again. So after knight b3, I played knight d7.
You know, Swapnil, I remember there is also this move c5. You take, take queen f5 check and you take back. But
yeah, it is a playable option for sure.
It's a playable. So knight d7 is more positional.
Yeah. But anyways, we need to play c5 at some point or the other. White plays knight f3 if I'm not wrong. And then we play. I think I played a6 in this position.
Ah. Stopping bishop b5 later after c5.
Right. So I think, but when I discussed this line with Adipan, you know, he plays every opening. So we discussed once, and he then suggested a very interesting idea. He suggested to play c5 first in this position. And only when white takes queen to c5, then we play a6. So in this way, we force him to take on c5. Because in the game, as we will see, Eliano did not take on c5. So that a6 move, you know, it's kind of a waste. It's kind of a waste of time. So after a6, Eliano played bishop e2.
Okay. So here, just to make it clarify, a6, bishop e3.
And then we can just play rook c8. Rook c8 should be fine.
And then pick up the pawn.
Yeah, then pick up the pawn. And in case white plays c3 for c5, then we don't need that a6 more, right? We can just go c4 straight away, as happened in the game.
Okay. So you save a tempo, basically.
We save a tempo, and then we go b5, e5 directly.
Atul Dahale in the chat says, after looking at the analysis, I'm feeling like playing Karokan. I always believed pushing the c pawn two squares is good. Now I'm feeling pushing it once. Also interesting. Yeah. I mean, it's always good to have two weapons, right? I mean, Karokan is
One solid and other dynamic.
Yeah, Nidorf is very dynamic. So, yeah. Okay, bishop e2.
Yeah, we can go
c5, c3. Oh, you got gained space. So you're playing on the queen side. You're not afraid. I think now white has to create some play on the king side here, you know, with pushing
his
pawns.
Correct. And I must say that Eliano, you know, managed to outplay me, and he created a lot of play on the king side. And this was the final round. So I needed to make a draw at the list to get into the prize list. So it was a really important game, a very critical game.
Knight f1. H6.
Yeah, making room for the bishop.
Castles, Knight e7, knight h5, okay.
So basically, it's just tying down the bishop on f8, creating some problems in my development.
This knight is a real headache because you can't push g6. It shuts down your bishop, also weakens the square. How do you get rid of it?
One good thing for me is that I have not castled on the king side yet. Otherwise, I would be facing mating attacks. So that's a very good news here for black. So yeah, we can go ahead with the game again.
I think in the chat also is your student Sankalp Gupta. I'm not sure he is the real Sankalp, but if he is Sankalp, he said, does he call you sir?
Yeah.
Okay, then he is. He says, good evening, sir.
Oh.
Okay.
No, maybe he is calling you, sir.
Knight b6.
Okay.
Knight e1. Oh, yeah, king what?
Yeah, I need to run away with my king before I get mated on the king side.
Really? You played king d7. Wow. Amazing. So if he starts attacking, you just put your king on the queen side.
Yeah, then he's welcome to attack on the king side, so I'm not afraid anymore. But unfortunately, I think as far as I remember, he started attacking on the queen side as well.
Yeah, yeah.
So that was really scary.
King is like, now should I start running again here? Okay, so bishop h5, you took the knight, the pesky knight.
The very annoying knight.
Yeah.
And then I played, I think, g6 h5. Mm. So I eliminate my light square bishop before playing g6 h5 so that it is not shut down.
Yeah. Bishop e7. f4. Oh, f5. Why?
Yeah, because I thought at some point I'll play g3, h3, g4, f5. But maybe f5 was a very dubious decision because even after the game, Vishy told me that f5 was not really required. So let him play h3,
Vishy Anand.
g4. And,
wow.
Yeah.
Wow. So he was looking at this game.
Yeah, he was. He looks at every game, actually. I was a bit surprised when I knew about it. But yeah, he follows all the games, all the good games of Indian chess players. Mm. So that is really surprising. But, you know, it's really nice to discuss with such great players. So f5, bishop f6, knight c2. I think, at some point around here, we already had less times. So this is Ilyanov with his typical maneuvering skills.
Yeah, but you are not less. Yeah, you also like danced with your knight to f5. And yeah, you have this weakness. But
yeah,
but also space. Black has a lot of space. And Swapnil is good at defense. So
yeah, now it's time to run away with the king here. Yeah?
The other side. Take. Oh, queen f5. I think now you're fighting back. Basically, this should be okay. This position.
Yeah, unless white has any pawn break on the in the position, I'm not really afraid because even though my king is still in the center, without any pawn breaks in the position, my king is safe. And you can see how stable my knight's positions are. For example, the knight on f5 is really feeling very, very stable here. So around here, I was pretty confident that I've already made a comeback in the game. And yeah, after a few moves, the game ended in a draw.
He offered a draw here?
Yeah, he offered a draw. And that was...
and you finished what, 8th maybe in the tournament?
I finished joint third, actually.
Joint third, yeah. And you won a lot of prize money, right? It was a big event.
Yeah, true. I won a lot of prize
money.
What was
the prize money?
I think it was around 1 lakh or something.
Okay.
Even more important thing was that I managed to finish joint third with legends like Kramnik, Caruana, all these
players.
So that was really grateful.
And you can check that article on Chessbase India. It's an interview of how Swapnil performed. I also remember the number at a rating ELO of 2768. I think that was his rating performance. Fantastic play by Swapnil over there. So that was a...
Yeah, and I played only the Karukan defense. So it was quite memorable.
And he was undefeated against guys like Eliano, Granda Zuniga, Nigel Short,
Gawain Jones.
And he used the Karukan. Brilliant. So Swapnil, I think, can we just look at one final game against Zuniga, Granda Zuniga, because that was your other draw in that tournament.
Yeah, sure.
And I must tell the viewers, Granda Zuniga is an experienced GM from South America, I think Peru, if I'm not wrong.
Yeah.
And he
and also it's
yeah.
continue.
Yeah, he's basically very experienced and very creative GM.
Very original player, actually. It's very difficult to prepare against him because he just comes on the board and he decides what to play now. So, so that's quite interesting. So he went for a very cool sideline here. E4, C6, D4, D5, AD, CD. So that line which we are talking about,
yes,
that quite
I think this is very important what you did here. Let's see. I think, Swapnil, we had a discussion once. It was like...
Yeah.
I was telling you should play queen c7 here to stop bishop f4, and you were like, no, it doesn't matter, knight f6 is a good move in this position. it's okay if he develops here, black is still completely fine. But in the game you did play knight f6.
I played knight f6, and you know, just before going for this tournament I prepared this line, and I was glad that I got to use it so quickly. So after knight f6, bishop f4, bishop g4. So we develop our bishop out of the pawn chain before we play e6.
Yeah, absolutely. So e6 and then maybe bishop e7, bishop d6 and castle is the main plan. And queen b3 is a slightly, how do you put it, like inconveniencing move?
Yeah, because you know, it's not so easy to defend the pawn on b7. Usually the correct way would be to play rook b8, but that is not available for black.
Yeah.
We don't want to weaken our queen side with b6. So there only remains, let's say, two options. Queen b6 is again not very comfortable for us because takes. He always has bishop c7 ideas, which makes it really uncomfortable, right? So the two main options for black is to play, or to play queen d7 and queen c8. Usually the main move here is to play queen c8, but it is a bit passive, even though I have played it in a lot of games previously. But after studying this line deeply, I realized that queen d7, even though it looks risky, because you know, white knight can always land on the e5 square with the tempo, which could be dangerous. But after studying this line deeply, I believe queen d7 is a very comfortable option for black.
Okay. I believe queen d7, later on, white can go knight d2, knight f3, and knight e5 maybe comes with a tempo. So people do prefer queen c8 sometimes. But let's see.
Yeah, so that's the main concern for black. We play e6, knight gf3, and now it's important to play bishop
d6. I thought you would. Oh, so you're giving up a pawn.
Yeah, but as we'll say, it's risky for, you know, black, white to take the pawn, because takes, if he takes queen into b7, we can play rook b8 first, queen a6, and now we can simply go for short castle.
And this is hanging now, and there's no real good way to defend it.
Yeah, and if white dares to play b4, you know, trying to keep the pawns,
let's ask the viewers.
Then we can, yeah.
Okay. Interesting position. Swapnil is like a machine at the Karo Khan. He can go on and on, and he can kind of teach you everything. I'm already running out of stamina. What about you guys? So many lines. What do you do here? Let me think. So my plan is to go e5. I want to break open the center. But the queen on a6 is not letting me do that because it's pinning my knight here. So I can't do this. So maybe I want to go rook b6 and e5. But let's see in the chat. What do people say? Knight b4? What, guys? You want to give up your queen? Just for... Chess Arco says knight b4. Nikhil Dixit in the chat. Nikhil, great work by Sagar. I was waiting for Swapnil and Setu books on Chess Base India store. Nikhil, just because of the COVID situation is getting delayed, but Swapnil's book on the Petrov will be soon there. Hopefully also Setu's book. Greetings from Bosnia and Herzegovina. Muammar Fajik. Oh, fantastic. Rook b6, rook into b4, rook b6. I think, Swapnil, everyone's suggesting rook b6.
Yeah, correct. Yeah, you got it right. We need to first kick the queen from a6 square, and then we are going to break with e5. And it is really uncomfortable for white because his king is still in the center, and we are getting tempo on each and every
move. And if you take, it comes with a check, and
Yeah, it is just devastating to white.
So that's important.
Yeah. So.
So he didn't take. He actually played knight e5.
Yeah, and then I just played queen c7.
And this was all preparation.
Yeah, this was preparation. And knight g4, bishop f4, knight f6, g f6. It is already opposite color pieces and a very solid position for black. The only drawback, if you compare both the sides' pawn structure, is that the h pawn is slightly lonely here. But that's why my next moves are h5 and h4 if possible. You know, advance the pawn and gain space on the king side. And after a few moves, you can see that black was really doing completely fine. Mm.
So queen c2, h5, long castle, h4, king b1. Oh, you took that pawn there?
Yeah.
Came back.
So basically we just exchanged the h-pawn,
which is into your favor.
Yeah, correct.
F5. Guys, this is really high class play by Swapnil. He's playing against world class GMs and drawing against them without breaking a sweat. You can't do that in normal terms. So that shows that Karo Khan is pretty solid, you know, as an opening. Knight jumps. I think you are already beginning to get a small edge here, no?
Yeah, basically you offered me a draw somewhere around here, but I thought let's continue because I'm not risking anything
here. Nice. So that's why you're not exchanging the queens. Now finally you did accept the draw.
Yeah.
But fantastic game. Very nice draw. In fact, Swapnil had a few more games to show, but we can do it some other time with S. Nitin, and you know, he had some very nice positional wins in this. But what I wanted to show you guys was the entire concept of Karo Khan, how it works, also the lines, so that you can know what are the main lines, and also these games at the end which give you an idea. Okay, so just before we end this session, so Swapnil, I want to take you here. I want to make you a little smaller in size. Okay. And where is the... How do I go to your course?
No, I think I sent a link on your WhatsApp, right? So if you go through it, it's easy for you.
Let me check that out. So Swapnil, basically, how long do you think someone would take to learn the Karo Khan opening?
Well, I'm still learning, so there is no concrete answer to that. But I think if someone is completely new, or even if someone has been playing Karo Khan, this course will help him a lot.
Okay.
Because first of all, any newcomer can learn. He gets a very complete reporter on the Karo Khan defense. So after going through this course, he can of course start implementing all these lines, all these ideas, all my hard work and years of experience. And I think that this could be a very good starting point for someone who hasn't played Karo Khan before. And also for someone who has been playing Karo Khan for a while, and especially when he faces variations like advanced variation, which is, as we discussed, it's a real headache for the black players. So if they want some really concrete preparation against it, this course is really going to help them.
Okay. So just having a look at this, I see this, it's on your website called Chess Pathshala. Guys, Swapnil owns a chess academy called Chess Pathshala. And he has a play the solid Karo Khan like a grandmaster, a detailed video course created by Swapnil. Okay, this is your intro.
Do you want to learn a solid option against white's first move e4? If yes, then here is a very good opportunity for you. Hi, this is
Swapnil. What high quality video. I mean, where did you shoot it? It's amazing.
Master Swapnil Dhopade, yeah. And I have played hundreds of tournaments
to my wife.
She shot it.
And games in the Karo Khan defense. In fact, Karo Khan had always been my main reporter, my main weapon against the first move e4, right until I have achieved my grandmaster title.
Fantastic. So this is the intro, and what 48 videos you get to see 48 videos.
Yeah. Yeah, correct. And also one very important thing about this video course is that it is not just a video course, but at the end of each and every line, I have also attached the PDF notes and model games in the PDF format. So players can download it and, you know, when they want to revise the line before
you
a
mean
game
PGN?
Or before a match.
No, PDF and PDF. Also, okay, they can just copy it and put it in the Chessbase PGN.
Yeah, correct. Right. So that would be very helpful for the players.
So first there's an overview, then e4, c6, f4. These are all the sidelines, e4, c6, knight e2.
Right. So I tried my best to cover all the sidelines and of course the main lines as well. So, and you know, I've not just given one video for one chapter or something like that. I've tried to, you know, divide the lines as well. So I've tried to give as much content as possible in this course.
Swapnil, this is tremendous work. This is like you put in the time, how much, everything.
Yeah, it almost took me like one and a half months to create this entire course.
Wow. And I guess if someone looks at it, then they can get a very good idea. Do you show it on a chess board or do you show it on a 2D board like we saw right now?
I show it on the 2D board because that is much easier since there are a lot of complications and analysis.
Right.
So it is easier to show it on the 2D.
I'm scrolling chapter 9, chapter 10, chapter 11, chapter 12. Oh, does this end? Chapter 13? 14.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
That's cool.
So basically, guys, check this out. Mods, if you can just put this link in the description. I have put it in the description. It's the first link in the description. You can also put it in the chat right now so that people can get this. I think, Swapnil, thank you so much.
And also, it's easier for people to visit, you know, videos.books, videos-books.chesspatshala.in.
Okay, what is that? There are more stuff there?
Yeah, this is the first video course and slowly we'll be adding a lot of video courses.
Brilliant. Guys, stay in touch with Swapnil through his Instagram, through his Facebook, through his YouTube channel. He's doing some phenomenal work. And Swapnil, thank you. It was a great pleasure to have you here.
Thank you, Sagar. Thank you so much for the stream. I really enjoyed, you know, teaching Karukan to Chessbase India viewers. And thanks a lot for all the people who stayed connected for this entire stream.
Yeah, a lot of.
And I hope you guys learned a lot. And yeah, do check out my course. It will help you a lot.
Definitely. So, Swapnil, we will do that. Thanks once again and see you soon.
Yeah, welcome. Bye-bye, everyone.
Okay, guys, that was Grandmaster Swapnil Dhopade teaching you the Karokan opening, and I hope that you guys benefited a lot. Please let me know in the comments. I want to talk with you. I want to understand if doing these sessions help you. Does it give you value, or is it like too difficult? I didn't understand anything. That was too quick. How was it? So let me know right now. Also, Murli Funny, thank you so much for putting in all the links. In general for the people. Niklesh Prabhakar says, I'm learning so much in one day in comparison to reading weeks and weeks of Grandmaster Preparation series. That is fantastic to know. Akshat Chenoy says, thanks, that was good. Ilam Parthi is just here. Oh, Ilam Parthi, you missed a good session. Ilam Parthi, watch it again. It will be very nice. Gaurang B, yes, very good session. Alvin Rajan says, understood it. Nikilesh Prabhakaran, I need more GMs. Swapnil Dhopade, amazing player. Nikilesh, go to his website, check out his course. And also, yeah, subscribe to his YouTube channel. Sutharsun Ashok says, Swapnil, can you talk a little bit about Atomic Habits by James Clear? I know, I remember Swapnil had that book on his table. Next time he comes here, we'll ask him about Atomic Habits. Ayush Krishna, thanks, Sagar. Very good session. We'll play Karokan for sure. Fantastic. Ritvik Kala, time to switch to Karokan again. Really impressed with all the variation. Very nice. Pratham Chess, thanks for letting me deviate from my main repertoire. Hey, always good to have double openings in your repertoire. Blindfold chess, I've improved a lot. Arnav Vasan, just perfect. Shubham Dudeja, thanks for these wonderful streams. Mayur Gondarekar, where were you, Mayur? This was an important session for you. Sankalp Gupta says, I'm the real one. Okay, Sankalp, fantastic. Great to have you. Akshat Shinoy, yes. Please have a look at this video again, guys. See, I can give you the PGN file. It's just one click for me and you can all get it. But the best way and most useful for you is to watch the video again and jot down all the moves. That will help you to grasp the opening better. And if you want a further understanding of it, go to Swapnil's website. That's the link in the description and learn from it. Okay, now that was a great session and I hope that you guys will join me again tomorrow. In one day starts the Olympiad. It's going to be exciting. But before that, tomorrow we have something interesting planned. Take care. Bye bye. See you. Do like the stream, yeah, and subscribe to Chessbase India. I always forget that.